Good afternoon and welcome to the City Club of Cleveland. I'm Hugh McKay, President of the Board of Directors of the City Club. It has been said that the Ohio State University is an elephant and it has to be a ballerina. Actually, that was said by today's speaker, Dr. E. Gordon Gee, President of the Ohio State University. Dr. Gee oversees Ohio State's 6 campuses, 64,000 students, nearly 40,000 faculty and staff, a payroll of $1.6 billion, and a budget of nearly $5 billion, the size of some state budgets. Dr. Gee meets his daunting job duties with legendary high energy. His day begins at 4:30 a.m. He skips lunch, luckily not today, and says there should be no wasted time. Around campus, he is highly visible around all facets of the community. And around Ohio, he is barnstorming every county in the state on behalf of OSU. It is not surprising that a poll found Dr. Gee would easily be elected governor of Ohio if he were to run. Dr. Gee has said being president of a major public university is the most political, non-political office. Dr. Gee is not afraid to make waves as he campaigns to advance his vision for OSU, including as a major engine for economic development in Ohio. He has told other university leaders that the recession may be a blessing if it forces schools to, quote, wholly reinvent ourselves, unquote, and that universities should consider, quote, blowing up, completely eradicating, unquote, academic departments and getting away from required doctorates for professors in favor of real-world experience. The president of Harvard criticized Dr. Gee's view as being too focused on, quote, immediate and worldly purposes, unquote. Dr. Gee responded that, quote, we make no apologies for working to ensure that our graduates have the skills needed to thrive. Dr. Gee graduated from the University of Utah with honors, earned his JD and education degrees from Columbia. He clerked on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the 10th Circuit and worked for Chief Justice Warren Burger. As something of a wunderkind, he was named president of West Virginia University in 1981. He then served as president of the University of Colorado, then OSU, then Brown University, then Vanderbilt. Then he returned to Ohio State as president in 2007. Dr. Gee is active in many national professional and service organizations, including the board of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and Museum here. He has received numerous honorary degrees, awards, fellowships, and he's the co-author of 8 books and the author of numerous papers and articles. Dr. Gee has called himself, quote, a bit odd, somewhat evangelical, but not crazy, unquote. Time magazine has called him the nation's best college president. Please welcome to the City Club, Dr. E. Gordon Gee.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And Hugh, that's exactly the way that I wrote that. I really appreciate that. Thank you very much. Wonderful to be with you. And let me just say, first of all, I am really honored to be here. This is an intimidating place, as you know, because there are a lot of smart people here, and you know exactly what you're doing. But I'm a great believer in the power of civil discourse, very much so. So I'm a great believer in the City Club. And of course, you've had before you people who are very intriguing and who do all sorts of things. And I hope today that I'll be able to be a little intriguing. Most important thing, though, is the fact that I have an opportunity to talk about Ohio State, about all of us together, about building a great community. This forum, of course, is one of Ohio's great treasures, and I'm grateful for that. Hugh, I thank you for the introduction. He himself is a wunderkind, having done almost everything possible, a Brown graduate. I served a cameo amount of time there. I was there for about 3 years, and so I know very well that he received one of the great educations. I might say that your introduction is much kinder than some that I have received recently. I was recently being introduced by someone who said, you know, what's the difference between a university president in the middle of the road and a pig in the middle of the road? And the answer was that there are skid marks in front of the pig. So that is a little bit of what my life has been like lately. But my thanks to Margot Copeland and to KeyBank. Margot is not only a Buckeye through and through. She also sits on the Kent State Board, sending over information so we can spy on them. I appreciate that. And very effectively so, but a great friend of mine personally, and I'm deeply appreciative of that. And Barbara Snyder, the president of Case Western Reserve, Reserve has done a wonderful job here. Case is an institution that is flourishing and under leadership. I take full credit for Barbara because I gave her her first administrative appointment to chair the Athletic Council at The Ohio State University. I wish she was still chairing it, as a matter of fact. Louise Proenza, my dear friend Louise, who is here, University of Akron, has done a great job, has transformed that university and that community. So I'm grateful to Louise also. And my thanks, I say this most sincerely, my thanks to all of you for giving me this opportunity to share my perspective as I look out from the center of America's most complex and most vibrant and most interesting and sometimes most pothole-filled university. It is a view that I never tire of, a view that reaches well beyond the boundaries of our campus, around the world, around the state, and around this community. In fact, each summer I venture from Columbus to go out and try to visit as many counties as I can. I enjoy that very much. I was telling the story this morning about the fact that I came from Colorado, 21 counties, and I was president of the University of Colorado. I visited 19 of them just by moving between the campuses. I had visited the other two in a very cameo moment, and then I would say I had visited every county in the state, and I'm standing up, engaging in flourishing flourishing words about how glad I am to be coming to Ohio in 1990, and I said, and furthermore, I'm going to visit every county every year, and I turned around and said, how many counties are there? And they said 88, and I tried to move back to Colorado, but it did not work. But nonetheless, I did visit 88 counties my first year, and then 44 every year after that. And so when I returned in 2007, I said, I'm going to visit every county in the state this summer. So I went out, and I decided I was going to do one really fun thing, which was the fact that I was going to milk a cow in every county. I thought, you know, the great land-grant tradition coming from Brown, and then Vanderbilt, I'm going to get back in the land-grant tradition. So I pulled up to the first cow in the first county. No one told me that when they raised their tail, they did the damnedest things in the world. So that was the end of my cow in every county. I now plant a buckeye tree in every county. I want you to know that. So I have ventured forth into all of our counties. And what is wonderful is that folks from all walks of life come out to say hello. Current students, graduates from years ago, parents who have sent us their children, people who cheer on the Buckeyes with all of their heart. But I tell you this, every person I meet, like all Ohioans, is a part of the Ohio State family. Everyone, no matter where you go to school, no matter where you are, no matter what you're the president of, everyone is a Buckeye. And for that, I'm very grateful. So people ask me the question about the university, about myself, where do I get all these bow ties? It's a popular one, and naturally some ask questions about Ohio State football. And so before I get to the heart of my remarks today, I will share with you what I've said to them. And it is this: yes, we were caught in a storm, but I can assure you we will never, never tolerate anyone seeding the clouds. We will emerge as an institution strengthened for the future with a world-class system of compliance and a continuing commitment to follow the letter and spirit of the rules. And I would also add, and I'm just going to update you a little bit, I would also add one other thing. Today I joined 65,000 students, 515,000 living alumni, the largest alumni body in the world, and literally countless others in raising our flag and wearing those great scarlet and gray colors of which I'm wearing right now with great pride. But I will also tell you that it has not sometimes been easy. Someone asked me the other day what it's been like over the last 6 months running America's largest institution, and I hearkened back to a story that I found. I pulled it out. It's a story that I found when I was president of West Virginia University. 1981, there was a trial taking place in Clarksburg, West Virginia. And this trial was just concluding, and I pulled out this clipping because I always thought it was kind of the best description of what it's like running a university, and particularly over the last 6 months. And this is the description, and Hugh, you'll appreciate this. During the trial, the attorney for the plaintiff introduced into evidence the weapons he said the defendant had used in a fight with his client: a huge fence post, a dagger, a pair of shears, a saw, a pistol, and a World War II saber. In his counter-argument, the lawyer for the defendant produced weapons he claimed the plaintiff had employed: a scythe, a hoe, a double-bladed axe, a sledgehammer, a shovel, a shotgun, a hog-skinny knife, and a pair of tongs. After deliberating, the jury filed back into the courtroom, and the foreman stood to read the verdict. "We, the jury, have talked it over," he said solemnly, "and we've decided that we would give $1,000 to see that fight." America, America, and its universities, I will tell you this. But, you know, I've also received, as you can imagine, I received thousands of emails, but I thought I'd just share a couple of them with you. Dear X, dear, I won't say what she said. I cannot help but notice that you are quoted everywhere on every news and sports website. Your words are being used against you, sometimes viciously. Can you please, for once, stop talking? That was signed by my daughter. I want you to know that. Literally. So, of course, you know, my daughter and I have this great thing. Dear Rebecca, I would email a reply, but the Columbus Dispatch would surely want copies of every email we've exchanged for the past 20 years. Call me, darling. So, this is the one that I really appreciate. Now, I've thought about whether I should use this, but I will. During one of these flurries of the football thing, I received this one. I received about, I don't know, about 13,000 emails in about 45 minutes one day. It was during one of my opportune moments. And this one had on the moniker on it, it said thank you. And so I thought, well, great, someone is sending me a thank you. And I opened it up and said, dear stupid, for doing your part in ruining college football for legions of fans, you stink. And here is my response. So that came at about 9:05. This was my response. It was signed Brian. And so I decided to have a little fun with Brian. I said, dear Brian, I've just received this email supposedly from you. Someone must have your email account, which you should check. Thought it was very clever. And then at about 9:24, this one comes in, to which we replied, dear President Gee, all of a sudden I'm no longer stupid. I had no idea you actually read your emails, he said. Said, please, 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 do not withhold my diploma. It's one of my students. He's doing very well at Penn State right now, I can assure you that. This one I used yesterday, but this one I just I get these great ones. This one came in just this week. Dear President Gee, I just saw that Ohio University in Athens has just been named the #1 party school in the nation by the Princeton Review. As an incoming freshman to Ohio State, I am very disappointed. I thought Ohio State aspired to be #1 in everything. Once I arrive on campus, I will make it my personal mission to improve our party school ranking, just so you know. That is Brent from Strongsville. I won't use Brent's last name. So, of course, Brent got a note from me. Dear Brent, thanks for your email. Upon further review of your high school transcript and test scores, it seems we made a mistake in admitting you. I am so sorry. The good news is Ohio University still has a few spots open in this freshman's class. Good luck. So, anyway, it is what it is. So I thought I would just share that with you to let you know what we're doing. Now, you will not be surprised to learn that my office on campus is overflowing with scarlet and gray and adorned with reminders of the blessings of a life lived in and dedicated to education. That has been my life. I also have a very unstable employment pattern, as you've also heard. And there are overstuffed shelves filled with books covering all manner of inquiry, photographs, and mementos from the 5 universities I have been fortunate enough to lead. There are posters from the movies Ferris Bueller's Day Off, my favorite movie, and Animal House. I also like Animal House. That serve as a daily reminder to me of the certain joy that can only be found in students occasionally, if blissfully avoiding their responsibilities. And on the opposite side of the room, in a large frame, in the line of sight of all my guests, is a quote that lies at the heart of how I approach leading Ohio's university. The quote is not from Plato or Thomas Aquinas or John Dewey. Instead, the philosopher in question is a person with a good deal more hands-on experience in the matter of solving problems and leading people. There, on an easel, looming over the conference table, inserting itself in the proceedings every day, printed on a large font on an otherwise blank canvas, are the words of General Eric Shinseki. This is what the general said. If you don't like change, you're going to like irrelevance even less. Now, the general explained that the army had to change because the nation cannot afford to have an army that is irrelevant. To that, I would add, educators and institutions must change because the nation cannot afford universities that are irrelevant. The general believes that the pursuit of positive change creates what he calls irreversible forward momentum. Irreversible forward momentum. I like the sound of that. Translated into Latin, and I think you would have a world-class university motto, firmus protinus progressio. Let me say that again. Firmus protinus progressio. Irreversible forward momentum. To me, that is the essence of what we can do in a university. It is the essence of what we must do. Positive change and expanding and improving what we know and what we are capable of doing and how we impart knowledge and skills. That is the physics of academic momentum that flows from the university to our students, to our research partners, to our civic partners, and to all of our constituents. And from all those directly touched, the irreversible force that cascades outward to the communities and workplaces they inhabit is there. We must use that latent force within universities to maximum effect. Indeed, and this is it. This is what it's about today. My central point is this. Raising our universities from plateaus to peaks will surely elevate the state and the nation. Let me just say that again. Raising our universities from plateaus to peaks will surely elevate this state and this nation. And to achieve that rise, we must reimagine, reinvent, and even reconceptualize the university. Which is to say, I aim not merely to rethink what we do, but more fundamentally, rethink what we think. Rethink what the American university is and what it is capable of achieving. Kierkegaard once declared that a man's greatest fear is learning what he is truly capable of doing and becoming. I fear the same can be said of our universities. Today, however, we cannot be afraid of tearing down academic silos that impede the flow of solutions. We cannot be afraid to question whether we must cherish ritual to the point of being traditional about traditions. We cannot be afraid of climbing out of the tautological trap of doing things as they have always been done merely because they have been done that way forever. In fact, one of the most discouraging things I hear at Ohio State of the 550 things that I love about them is when someone says to me, but Dr. Gee, you can't do that. And I say, why? And they say, that's not the way we do things at Ohio State, as if Woody Hayes himself is still walking the campus. We cannot live in that world. It's an unforgiving world, and we cannot allow that to take place. The most powerful limitations on our universities, I will submit to you, are those that are self-imposed. And the time to break free is now. Let me acknowledge that embracing change is always an important driving force for universities, of course. We're in the idea business. Indeed, I could not have stood here at any stage in my academic career and kept a straight face while making a case for sloth. But today, the urgency is palpable. The great fortunes of the world were once forged by muscle and sweat in the mills and in the fields. Think of Cleveland. Now the great fortunes of the world are amassed from products of the mind. 100 years ago, about the time that the City Club was founded, the three richest Americans made their money in oil, steel, and timber, respectively. Now the three wealthiest people in this country derive their riches from software, finance, and software. Where once smokestacks, certainly in this city and beyond, were the metric of prosperity, today, I submit to you, it is the college bell tower. Clearly, our economic reality has been reset. The expectations of a century ago, a decade ago, even a few years ago, are no longer operative. But this is not reason to lament. The catalyst of virtually all future economic progress will be ideas. And to our great good fortune, that happens to be the stock and trade of our universities. In the State of the Union this year, President Obama said this nation faces a Sputnik moment in which our universities will be called upon to accelerate our economic progress past the limits of our imagination. In the State of the State this year, Governor Kasich said our economic future depends on colleges and universities giving Ohio the ability to lead in this country and be able to compete in the world. We need our universities more profoundly today than ever before. I submit that to you as a fact. And if for no other reason than the whole of the nation seems to have misplaced its confidence. A recent poll found nearly half of all Americans believe our best days lie in the past. Think about that. Americans are sharpening their pencils, ladies and gentlemen, preparing to jot down an obituary for a nation that, to just pick one field of endeavor, gave the world the telegraph, the telephone, the internet, and the iPad. Now, I understand this fear of decline, but I do not share it. This nation is exceptional. I say that not with arrogance, but with an unshakable optimism informed by belief in the power of education. And by the way, one can never be anything but optimistic when you're surrounded by 65,000 of the brightest people in the world every day. I've been to China many times over the years to meet with academic, business, and government leaders, as well as with the alumni and friends of Ohio State. On a visit several years ago, I was scheduled to have a 15-minute chat with the Chinese Minister of Education, responsible for the education of 1.3 billion Chinese. And instead of 15 minutes, after 3 hours of conversation, he said to me, and this was directly what he said to me, How do you Americans teach creativity? How do you Americans teach creativity? Well, I wasn't going to tell them. It's a state secret. But that question, I submit to you, is our answer. That question is our answer. Ladies and gentlemen, this country has long had a creative edge. De Tocqueville knew that. In the 1830s, he talked about the habit of the heart. That was the center of what was the great American spirit, the open door to the mind. But to maintain that edge, to best cultivate creativity in the next generation, we must cultivate it now in our universities. Universities simply must adapt to reach their full potential as a catalyzing force for a brighter future. Today, then, I want to share with you in just the few minutes I have several of the significant ways we are doing just that by reconceptualizing the Ohio State University. And if I were the president of the University of Akron, because Luis and I know each other very well, I could make the same case. If I were the president of Case Western Reserve and Barbara were making this speech, we would make the same case because we in this state are moving forward very aggressively in terms of the reconceptualization. But at my institution, we've begun by simply changing the way we understand the place. Where I once frankly described Ohio State as 18 colleges connected by a heating plant. Today we can honestly speak of one university, one powerful engine. We are one university that works in common purpose, that moves in common direction, and that produces uncommon results. Now that sounds the sort of thing a feel-good committee came up with, suitable for printing on a banner and then promptly ignoring it, and it will soon be forgotten. But there are tangible changes that follow this one university principle and are making us stronger in the process. Last year, we consolidated an array of schools and colleges into the nation's largest and most powerful College of Arts and Science. It wasn't easy. I tried that in 1990. I was thrown off the beaches every time I tried it. Came back in 2007. Either I'm smarter or the world has changed. But we did do that. We created a university framework plan that was recognized by our peers this year as the best of its kind in the nation. Instead of making piecemeal decisions, which is what has always happened in terms of universities in the past about constructing a new building here and a new facility there, our framework plan ensures that everything we build serves only the university mission. As we simplify university structures, we must also consider scaling the fences scholars have built around their professional work. The study of poverty, I submit to you, is a perfect example. I used this yesterday. Poverty is a subject within the domain of no single academic discipline. It falls at the intersection of human and economic and geographic forces, and it must be studied as such. And if there ever was a time and an issue that challenges universities and all of us to apply all that we know, this would certainly qualify. That is why we have created interdisciplinary centers for innovation and dedicated our first such center to bringing forth the full measure of Ohio State's capacity to find workable solutions to poverty. Let there be no doubt about this. Modern scholarship, devoid of fiercely guarded disciplinary boundaries, has life-changing capacity, and we intend to harness that capacity. All this rethinking is serious business, and it has a tendency to feed on itself. As we brought down divisions within the university and divisions among our faculty, it was not long before I asked what I thought was a much more important question. It's about partnerships. How do we bring down divisions between universities? In this era when the internet has opened a virtual door to crowdsourcing, far-flung minds are being marshaled to find unconventional solutions. In Ohio State, we decided we would try this with one partner somewhere. So Ohio State and Colorado State have now assembled our own crowd, 500 researchers strong across these two institutions. Together, we're working on energy and environmental research and economic development from the Rockies to the Appalachians and beyond. The effort, by the way, is led by Ron Sega, who holds a unique joint vice presidential appointment of Vice President of Ohio State and the Vice President of the University of Colorado State. I was the President of the University of Colorado. I keep getting that mixed up. And he has that joint appointment. Now, I know what you're thinking. It doesn't work. That is a long commute. But Ron Sega is a former astronaut, a veteran of two space shuttle missions. Yes, his offices may be 1,300 miles apart, but it is all relative to a man who racked up 7 million frequent flyer miles in space, I want you to know. The point is that it does work. And the point of this endeavor is plain. To be frank, this is the world we live in now. No one university can match the depth of expertise, research programs, facilities, regional advantages, and student talents available at 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 universities. We are sharing knowledge and resources and success, collaborating to search for answers that can only be found when we bring minds from the crowd together. In this region, we have strengthened great relationships with Cleveland State University. I was with President Berkman last night, with Case Western, and of course my friend from the University of Akron on a number of fronts. But most importantly, what we're doing right now is aeronautic research, and a founding issue for the state of Ohio. As we build more bridges within the academy, we also look outward in new ways, and we must do that. We are working more closely than ever before with industry partners to give our students the benefit of applied experience and give Ohio's economy the benefit of research expertise. Indeed, of all the great universities in this country, of which there are 3,600, Ohio State ranks second in industry-sponsored research. In Toledo, we are working with the Andersons on a revolutionary dispersible fertilizer. Right here in the neighborhood, in Highland Heights, we are working with Phillips Medical on biomedical imaging technology. Across the state, our Center for Automotive Research, the finest research facility of its kind in the world, is working with big three automakers to achieve new breakthroughs in fuel efficiency. Our efforts are strengthening Ohio employers and preserving and creating Ohio jobs. Yet, we must do more. For a very long time, this is a very interesting conundrum that I faced when I came to Ohio State, and Luis and others would appreciate that. Ohio State ranked 9th in terms of research productivity. Of the 3,600 colleges and universities in the country, we ranked number 9 in terms of research. We just crossed the $800 million mark in terms of funded research. Think about that. But yet, we ranked in the bottom quartile in terms of advancing that research to ideas. But now we're ready to move. We created a whole new system. We brought in Brian Cummings, who joined us this summer to lead our technology commercialization effort, and he brings with him a rather stellar track record. I stalked him for 6 months because he ranked number 1 in the nation in terms of commercialization in this country. He helped to create more than 100 university incubated startups at the University of Utah. These are the University of Texas before that. Brian has made it very clear that having great ideas without a plan to utilize them is akin to being very fast but having no map. With Brian's help, we will make that path move forward, and we will do it here in Cleveland, we will do it in Columbus, we will do it in Cincinnati, we'll do it with our partners in Akron, everywhere. Governor Casey has said, and I agree with him wholeheartedly, that our university should align what they do with the forces of job creation. Each of the changes I have mentioned today, each brick we remove from the great wall of academic inefficiency will help us meet those changes. Still, I'm pleased to note that there is already evidence of Ohio State's dynamic influence in the job market. In fact, a national survey of human resource recruiters ranked Ohio State as the nation's 12th best source of talent among all colleges and universities. And in the long run, our graduates achieved like few others. On another study found, Ohio State is among the top 10 producers of chief executive officers for corporate America. Nevertheless, we recognize that an increasing number of our students are not going to climb the corporate ladder as much as they are going to invent their own ladders or ramps or catapults. We know very little about the future shape of the economy that our students will face in 10 or 20 or 30 years, but what we do know is that instilling analytical thinking and the ability to adapt will serve our students well, no matter what twists and turns the economy may take in the future. Toward that end, we're building a curriculum that acknowledges many of our students will ultimately create their own jobs. Our efforts in this front have already drawn national attention. Inc. magazine highlighted our programs as part of a feature on the 10 best entrepreneurship programs in the nation. So reconceptualizing how we teach, what we study, whom we partner with, all this demands, indeed it relies upon a new financial model for universities. And this will be my last point. In Governor Kasich's and in legislative members from both parties, we are fortunate. Indeed, we are blessed because we have had bipartisan support for our universities unlike anything that I have seen around the nation. Grace Drake is here. Pat Sweeney are here. We had this great support in the 1990s. But then everything went south, as we all know. But they have now made an incomparable investment, knowing that change is necessary and that universities will be the catalyst. Indeed, their budgets and their historic decision to pursue construction and other regulatory reform bring us into the modern era. They just passed a construction reform package that overturned a 137-year-old law that was in existence to build canals in this state. That's not a modern state. And now we have taken care of that. By contrast, in other states, they are eating their seed corn. A few recent examples of this I will just give to you. New Hampshire has reduced state funding for higher education by 45%. Persistent budget reductions in Florida have resulted in state university tuition increases of 15% each of the last 3 years. In California, state funding was reduced by more than $1 billion this year, and tuition has jumped 50% in 2 years. Across the nation, similar pain abounds. Even across the pond, as they say, the renowned universities of Great Britain have fallen prey to the government's budget knife. I was in Europe just a few weeks ago pursuing new partnerships for Ohio State. At Oxford University, I saw the effects of government funding for the classroom having been reduced by 40%, and the university left to increase tuition by almost 200%. The University of Exeter's vice chancellor said of the government's budget, "We are being thrown out of the nest." Well, I sympathize with that plight, but at the same time, I recognize that we must all learn to fly on our own. We must broaden our economic base to sustain the achievements we are pursuing. This has been a breakthrough year for Ohio State on that front. In February, the chair of the Ohio State Board of Trustees, Les Wexner, and his wife, Abigail, announced they would make a transformative $100 million gift, the largest donation in the university history. Shortly before that, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services announced that our academic medical center had outpaced the other major cancer centers in this country to win a competitive grant of $100 million to support our medical center expansion project, creating lots of jobs and lots of opportunity. Now, I want to be clear that no financial model is of any value unless it protects Ohioans' access to their state universities. With support from the state, we have held tuition increases to a very bare minimum. In fact, now, this is something that's important because I get this question all the time. Inflation has outpaced Ohio State tuition over the last five-year period. Let me repeat that. Inflation has outpaced Ohio State's tuition over the last five-year period. And I would note we have moved to aggressively support our students. Our Student First, Student Now project, we were raising money, and all of a sudden we stopped on a dime. We went into this 2008 problem, and we stopped. We said, we're going to make certain that every student who is at this university will be able to afford to come to this institution. We started a fundraising project, raised $100 million almost overnight in support of our students. However, ladies and gentlemen, let me say this. As we rethink the way a university is run, we truly must rethink the way tuition is understood. Tuition is not an annual expense. It is a lifetime investment. Indeed, there are very few expenditures in life, I will submit, that entail temporary costs in exchange for lifetime value and enduring impact. College tuition is just one of those things. The differential in annual and lifetime earnings between those who have obtained a bachelor's degree and those who have only a high school degree is now well over $1 million. Think about that. So it is an investment. Moreover, it is an imperative that we properly understand the relative cost and value of higher education, lest we give comfort to the nascent voices questioning why we should expand access to higher education. I hear this all the time. Why do you need a college degree? One critic of the academy, himself a lifetime academic, often speaks of the waste of a mail carrier holding a college degree as if he had just spotted a fish buying a bicycle. How arrogant. How utterly arrogant to question the value of opportunity, the value of personal evolution, the value of nurturing the ability to adapt to a world and a workplace that will be changing all around us is a foolhardy proposition. Indeed, I would consider these assets invaluable. So, ladies and gentlemen, the case for reconceptualizing the American university is the case for the future. I would argue that all great societies look to the future. The animating principle that has carried millions of Americans to universities, that moved previous generations to build those universities, was a relentless belief in the future. No one would pursue the American dream, much less live it, nor even dream it, without a fundamental belief in what is yet to come. So I leave you today, and isn't the word finally a great word? It is. I will leave you today with a fascinating, if somewhat accidental, psychology experiment that illustrates the power of being able to look ahead. More than 40 years ago, Walter Mischel, this is something that I have read about several times and I was thinking about it for this speech. Walter Mischel, a Stanford psychology professor, was interested in studying impulse control in children. I now have grandchildren. I'm trying to figure this out. I have peanut butter all over my walls. They're visiting me. He rigged up a very simple test in which four-year-olds were brought into a plain room with a desk and a chair. On the desk was a marshmallow. Children were told they could eat that marshmallow at any time. However, if they waited 15 minutes, they would be given a second marshmallow. You will not be surprised to hear that two-thirds of the subjects did not get that second marshmallow. Professor Michel documented his findings and went on to other work. But several years later, he was moved to check back on his subjects, and here is what he found, which was truly fascinating. By any measure, the children who had been able to wait for the second marshmallow were doing much better in life. These big-picture, future-oriented four-year-olds went on to score 210 points higher on the SATs than their more short-sighted marshmallow-eating peers. They were more likely to be in good health. They were less likely to be in trouble with the law. They were more likely to be advancing in their careers. These were children who shared a very similar starting point in life but were headed in very different directions. To Professor Michel, the lesson is obvious. The single thing we can control about the world is how we individually think about it. If we are, in his words, strategic in our allocation of attention, if we think about the future instead of only about the present, then we can shape the future for our benefit. That, I submit to you, is the business of the American University and the imperative to reconceptualize. That is the mission of Ohio State. That is the direction of the great state of Ohio. Firmus Protinus Progressio, irreversible forward momentum. We will break down the barriers that impede us. We will regain our confidence. We must. And we will thrive. For we are the greatest country with the greatest universities, and the future is ours to claim if we are willing to look to it. So I thank you for letting me be here today.
Today at the City Club of Cleveland, we are listening to a Friday forum featuring Dr. E. Gordon Gee, president of The Ohio State University. We will return to our speaker in a moment for the traditional City Club questions. We encourage you to formulate your questions now, and please remember to keep them brief. The City Club would like to recognize the passing of one of our longtime members and former board presidents, Robert Cavano. Bob served as president of the City Club in 1979 and was a dedicated member for 41 years. His presence will be missed, but his spirit remains with us. In 2012, the City Club of Cleveland will turn 100 years old. We're planning a number of events and will be actively soliciting support from the community through our campaign for a new century. Our celebration will begin on October 10th this year with a major conference on free speech at the Allen Theater. To learn more about the 100th anniversary events, please visit the City Club website, www.cityclub.org/100. We welcome all of you here today and those listening to WCPN 90.3 FM, WCLV, WTAM, or one of the many radio stations across the country. Our television broadcast partner is WVIZ PBS IdeaStream. Television broadcasts of the City Club are made possible by Cleveland State University and PNC. Our live webcast is supported by the University of Akron. Today's program is part of the 2011 KeyBank Diversity Thought Leadership Series. At the head table today are Margot Copeland, Executive Vice President, Director, Corporate Diversity and Philanthropy of KeyCorp, and Chair of the KeyBank Foundation, and Maria C. Coyne, Executive Vice President, Business Banking Segment Group, Key Community Banking. Will you please stand and be recognized? We're also pleased to host students at our forum today who are here as part of our City Club student program. Participation of these students is made possible by a generous grant from the Fred E. Scholl Foundation, Bernard L. Carr Chairman. With us today are students from the Cleveland School of Science and Medicine. Will the students please stand to be recognized? Now we'd like to return to our speaker for our traditional City Club question and answer period. We welcome questions from everyone here, including guests. Holding the microphone today is 100th anniversary intern Phil Williams and program director Carrie Miller. First question, please.
Dr. Gee, I arrived at Morrill Tower in 1998, and fortunately I graduated before your return from your sabbatical in 2007. But my question is, how did the university change during your trip around the United States? And also, what did Presidents Kerwin and Holbrooke leave behind, maybe as a legacy of the university that you're now building upon in phase two?
Well, thank you very much. Thanks. So you, Morrill and Lincoln Tower, I might just note, are two great residence halls on the university campus built by out-of-work Soviet architects. Not the prettiest facilities in America, but everyone loves them, as a matter of fact. I've had occasion to be over there. I sleep overnight in the residence halls every once in a while. That's one I don't do. But anyway, I often talk about this. When I came in 1990, I'd come from Colorado and West Virginia. So I've been running universities for 10 years, and the intensity of being the president of Ohio State University is almost unbelievable. It not only is it because it's just a big university, and it is huge, and it's complex, and a variety of other things, but also the intensity of being the president of a university in this state. I think we all know that. Ohioans love Ohio, and Ohioans love that university in droves, and it... I wasn't certain whether I was going to thrive, but I got used to it. And so when I left 7 years later to go to Brown, I thought I kind of had it padded somewhere or other. I came back in 2007, and I will tell you, the university had changed dramatically. It seemed to me much more complex. It seemed to me to be much more focused on doing really great things. It had moved in, and I can say this because of the fact that I was president of two institutions, one ranked sixth, and I think the other ranked eighth in the nation in terms of their selectivity, a variety of other things. Ohio State had moved in the front ranks of American universities. We have a 94% retention rate, among the highest of any university, let alone public universities. We are one of the most selective institutions now among public institutions. Our research projects, as I just said, to give you one example, when I left, when I came in 1990, I think we ranked 36th in terms of research productivity. When I left, we focused on a number of things. We ranked 21st. That was a huge move. When I came back, we ranked 11th. We moved to number 9 just a year ago, or 2 years ago. We passed several great institutions in so doing. So I think the answer is that the fact that both Britt Kerwin and Karen Holbrooke did wonderful jobs. I, as you can imagine, it's not difficult to. It's very difficult to think about coming back for a second act. There have been a lot of failures in people doing that in any walk of life. But the university was so much different when I came back that I really felt like I had to relearn the university. I had to de-learn it in order to relearn it. It's a fabulous place. We are blessed to have one of America's great, remarkable academic institutions serving the state, and I'm very privileged to be there. Thanks for the question.
Good afternoon, Dr. Gee. Welcome to Cleveland. It was a privilege to see you at Stannard Farm, a few minutes east of downtown, where the OSU land extension is holding a classroom now 140 miles away from your main campus, working with people with disabilities in urban farming, which has made Cleveland the number one city for urban agriculture. Seems such an odd thing for a major modern university to be doing that. I'm wondering if you could comment on the relationship with the school and the city.
First of all, thank you very much. And there is the energizer right there. I love you. He's a graduate of John Carroll. He's now an honorary Buckeye. He has his bow tie pin on. He's ready to go. Go Bucks. We'll sing Kumbaya in a minute. But I think that is the misconception. The misconception is the fact that the university is in Columbus. Our university is in every corner of this state. No other institution has a spread as this institution through all of our extension programs. We run 4-H. We run all of the agricultural extension programs. We have research projects all around the state. And most importantly is the fact that we're dedicated to the people of the state. We are the Ohio State University. We're not the Ohio State University in Columbus, Ohio. And so our commitment is to Cleveland, to Cincinnati, to Akron, to any part of the state. And this opportunity, by the way, in this term, this urban farming program, is absolutely spectacular. Because what we've done is we've partnered with people who felt that they did not have a role in life. They felt that they were moving in a wrong direction. This is a city that has had tremendous economic challenges and is coming back stronger. I will tell you that. I'm a great believer in Cleveland. And part of that is because of the fact that the people of this city are investing in the lives and quality of life and these farms. And if you could go out and see these urban farms, I was there today, these wonderful young people who really did not have much opportunity, but now they're learning how to do this in this community, and they're producing about $3 million worth of agricultural products that are being eaten by all of us, maybe right here today, and more importantly, it can morph itself through all of this effort into about a $1 billion business. Think of that. Cleveland, Ohio, remaking itself in a 21st century way, and I really applaud you for allowing this to happen, and that's our privilege. And I was inspired by that today. I want you to know that. Questions?
Dr. G. A question that I thought you might have thought you'd be getting today. In the case of Jim Tressel, mm-hmm. in my opinion, students like Terrell Pryor, no matter how good they are, mm-hmm. ought to be kicked out as soon as they engage in that kind of deviltry. My question is, though, don't you think that once the media had the little bit of evidence against them that it was a preordained sleigh job on Jim Tressel, perhaps because Ohio State was winning so much compared to other places?
Is that a question?
It was a preordained question.
Well, first of all, let me just say that I'm pretty sensitive about that. My nerves are a little raw. I'll be very honest about that. And as you well know, Coach Tressel did wonderful things. I've always been on the record about the fact that the coach was a great a citizen of our university and was and remains and obviously was a fabulous coach, the winningest coach in the country. At the same time, what we have to understand is the fact that there are rules and regulations that we all have to live by, and the university is more important than the individual. It's more important than the president, the coach, or anyone else. And so, therefore, we have to live by those rules. And when the rules are ultimately broken, then we have to make certain that that we keep sight of that. As I've told you, as I said in my opening statement, as we take a look at this now through a little bit of the rearview mirror, the truth of the matter is the fact that we made some mistakes ourselves as an institution. I made some mistakes personally. I'm well known for saying very dumb things, and I admit that. I hope what I said today was not as dumb as some that I have said. But also, I think we've learned that there is a level of integrity of the university we can all take pride in. Yes, the media had a role in it. Yes. There were issues which we were not aware of. Yes, there were opportunities that we lost, but I hope that what we can do is, rather than laying blame at young people or anyone else, that we lay blame at the issue that a system needs to make certain that it works very well. And I'm dedicated to making certain our system and the NCAA system and college athletics works as well as it possibly can. And that probably is the best opportunity that we have. A lesson learned, but only learned if we make it better, and that's what we're trying to do right now. Question,
G. Yes. My question is somewhat similar to, but also different from the previous question. The plaintiff earlier this year reported that the compensation package to the football coach mm-hmm. was in excess of $3 million. Mm-hmm. When you compare that with the average compensation, I'm sure, to your faculty members, it's a multiple that's very significant. Mm-hmm. And my question is, basically, to what extent does a university such as Ohio State University try to evaluate the compensation that it pays to its faculty who are educating its students as compared to that which it pays to its athletic coach?
You know, that's a great question. Because of the fact that I think it's very important for us to value every citizen of the university, every faculty member. As you well know, there are forces that exist out there. First of all, let me just say about the football issue, I believe that there's an arms race, and I believe that we have to put a cap on it. I am very much in favor of that. I'm very much on record in that regard. We should not. We have escalated that beyond where we are, and we're going to, by the way, have a conversation about that this week among a selected number of university presidents in Indianapolis to see how we can get our arms around that. And with those escalating costs, really we are to blame. I mean, I am the senior university president of the country, so if you can blame anyone for some of that arms race, blame me. And so I'm
So I'm here doing a recompense at the moment, number one. Number two, though, is the fact that we do have various kinds of forces. For example, we bring in a young assistant professor of neurosurgery. We may pay him $1.5 million. And the reason is the fact that that's what neurosurgeons make, and we want to be very competitive with the Cleveland Clinic and others. And so my role as university president is to make certain our faculty are paid very competitively in the world in which they live. If I could be king for a day, I would want to pay everyone absolutely the best that we could possibly pay as an institution. But my role right now is to make certain on the competitive scale that we are very competitive with the institutions with whom we find ourselves in the Big Ten and in the major American universities around the country. And so I'm hopeful that we're going to be able to continue to do that. But that's a great question.
What do you think about the rise of for-profit universities such as the University of Phoenix, and what have you learned from that?
Well, in the early 1990s, when all this technology just abounded, all of a sudden everyone said the universities are going to disappear. We're going to move from brick universities to click universities, and we're all going to be bound by technology. And today, you know, I'm on my running machine early in the morning. I'm watching the news, and this young lady comes on. She says, "I am in my pajamas, and I'm earning a college degree." Young lady, you're not earning a college degree. You're getting something, but you're not earning a college degree. What you're getting is a certificate. Thank you very much. In your pajamas, that's not education. What education is, and this is what I believe very, very firmly. And by the way, I think the technology plays an extremely important role, and I think that all of these issues are enormously important in how we use technology. We need to control it rather than having it control us. But I can assure you this, and clearly at Brown and at Vanderbilt, I learned this, and this is our role at Ohio State, I'm moving to require both freshmen and sophomores to live on campus. And the reason for this is the fact that that I have them in class for 18 hours a week. And let me tell you something. They get a great education for 18 hours a week. But what about the other 150 hours? And if we just say we house them, we feed them, and kumbaya, and we don't do anything, and it's that 150 hours, the most important learning experience in a student's life are those conversations late at night, those pizza events, all those other kinds of things that take place that really are an educational experience. And I will tell you that you can't do that in an environment which is simply is about going from A to B with a degree. And that is the reason that the great American university is going to continue to be very much along the lines of the institution that I've talked about. Reconceptualize, though, and we just say what I said today is the American university is fundamentally broken and we've got to reorganize it. But it doesn't mean to say that we reorganize it based upon that kind of for-profit model. There's a role to play. It's not the right role in terms of the fundamental intellectual values of this country.
My dad was a water boy for the Ohio State football team right before World War II.
I'll probably be one this year.
Truly one of his truly one of his proudest accomplishments. Mm-hmm. But I'm wondering, you talked about now having a world-class system of compliance. I wonder if you can share with us a few things that you've done in the wake of things to now have that world-class system.
First of all, let me say that what we discovered is the fact that our compliance system was not broken. What was broken was people. You know, we had some students who sold tattoos. We had some. We had a coach who didn't put forward. Unless the system itself worked pretty well. But what we have done is we went to the ground. We took a look and said, now how can we make certain that we don't have some of those breakdown? Did we ask the right question? My view is this in terms of compliance. My view is the fact that universities ask the first question: did you do it? We don't ask the second question, is why did you do it, who else did it, the other kinds of things. And I think that the thing that I've learned, if there's any mistake that I have made as university president in this regard, that I would fundamentally correct, and that is the fact that I would develop a way for us to ask the next question. Because that's when you find out the real answer. That's number one. Number two is that in terms, we took a look at all of our compliance issues. One of the problems we have in our institution, so big, so diverse, so you have the compliance officers reporting to the people who are in charge of the institutional entities. One of the things we're going to do is we're going to centralize compliance centralize compliance so that there's always a dual reporting relationship. I think that is very important. Let's just use use the internal auditors, for example. They report to the CFO. They now report to the CFO and the president and the board, just to make certain that we have a check and balance. And I think that that's an important issue. But first, ask the right question, then ask the second right question, then ask the third right question, and then secondly, make certain you have double checks in terms of your compliance system. Those two, I think, will make a lot of difference. Questions? Okay, I guess I'm done.
Today at the City Club of Cleveland, we've been listening to a Friday forum featuring Dr. E. Gordon Gee, president of The Ohio State University. Thank you, Dr. Gee. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This forum is adjourned.
For information on upcoming speakers or for podcasts of the City Club, go to cityclub.org.